Coming up next on Arizona Horizon, jobs and economic development. Find out what Valley business leaders are urging state lawmakers to accomplish in 2012. And a team of ASU engineering students is honored by Entrepreneur Magazine. We'll show you what earned the students that distinction. Those stories next on Arizona Horizon.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Eight, members of your Arizona PBS station. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Phoenix has a new mayor. Greg Stanton took the oath of office this morning. Stanton was sworn in by former Arizona Governor Rose Mofford at a ceremony inside the historic Orpheum Theater. During his inaugural address, Stanton announced a new partnership between ASU, the Mayo Clinic, and the private sector to develop a major bioscience center around the Mayo Clinic's 210-acre campus in North Phoenix. Democratic State Senator Kirsten Sinema today announced her candidacy for Arizona's new Congressional District 9. Sinema is an Arizona native. She was first elected to the State House of Representatives in 2004. She declared her candidacy today in an online video. And a state Senate ethics investigation of Senator Scott Bundgaard will move forward. A Maricopa County Superior Court judge today dismissed a lawsuit filed by Bundgaard's attorney that looked to stop a committee hearing scheduled for this Thursday. Judge John Buttrick dismissed the suit, saying the court has no authority in what is a purely political matter. The ethics hearing focuses on an alleged domestic dispute between Bundgaard and a former girlfriend. The Peoria Republican doesn't believe he'll get a fair trial from the committee, which could recommend Bundgaard be removed from office. Business leaders will host the governor and top lawmakers this Friday at the 2012 Legislative Forecast Luncheon. The event allows the business community to express a wish list of sorts for the upcoming legislative session. And here to talk about those legislative priorities are Glenn Hammer, President and CEO of the Arizona Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Todd Sanders, President and CEO of the Phoenix Chamber of Commerce, and Farrell Quinlan, State Director of the Arizona Chapter of the National Federation of Independent Business. Good to have you all here. Thanks for joining us tonight on Arizona Horizon.
Great to be here.
Thanks for having us.
Before we start with what you want from the next legislative session, what'd you get from the last one that you're happy with?
Ted, I appreciate how you phrase it. We had a phenomenal session last year. And we give the governor and the state legislature all the credit in the world for passing a once-in-a-generation competitiveness package. At its core, it dramatically reduces our corporate income tax rate as well as our business property tax rates. It also creates a transformational entity in the Arizona Commerce Authority. And we saw today with Don Cardin and Jerry Colangelo and the governor what that legislation really means. And what that meant today was Silicon Valley Bank announcing it's going to bring several hundred well-paying jobs to the state of Arizona. I don't believe that would have been possible without the passage of the competitiveness package.
Something that like that not possible without things like corporate tax cuts and property tax reductions and the Commerce Authority?
I think that's a huge component to it. I think for a long time, especially down at the legislature, the economic development strategy kind of revolved around golf courses and sunshine, and this really puts us on the map. I think things started when we looked at Senate Bill 1403, which was the solar and manufacturing incentives bill, and I think we're starting to grow on that, and there's some real momentum there. So I would agree with Glenn.
Farrell, you know, some critics out there are saying there's way too much emphasis on big business, on the big stuff, as opposed to the little guy. What do you say about that?
Well, you know, a lot of, you know, like 1,300 bills are introduced every year, and about 350 ever get passed. And you probably only talk about a dozen or two on this program. So there's a lot that goes on at the legislature that's very important, and a lot of that having to do with regulatory reform. This is a very pro-reg reform legislature and governor. And we've seen a number of areas where the majorities that were elected in November of 2010, you know, really, you know, grabbed onto some really big issues. And hopefully this coming session, they'll actually see fruition of some of their wants when it comes to taxation, regulation, and litigation. That the three things, the three inputs from government that usually hamper business development and growth.
Well, let's go to taxation first. Capital gains tax relief, that's what you're looking for, among other things?
Actually, small businesses are really looking for some sort of relief when it comes to equipment and manufacturing things such as the equipment that we use to create jobs. Mm-hmm. There's a proposal to increase the exemption on that, and we're looking for some relief when it comes to regulation at the local level, applying some of the same protections and standards that the state and federal government provide businesses at the county and local level. And when it comes to litigation, there are things we can do to curb lawsuit abuse, and all those things are going to hopefully make some gains this year.
I want to get to tort reform in a second here, but as far as taxation relief and regulation relief, someone out there is saying it seems like that's all we hear from the legislature. How much more do you need?
Well, I think that what we need is a strategic approach to it. And as I said, I think that that's what we're starting to see is a real thoughtful approach to how we're going to go about doing this. Like the fact that the Glenn mentioned today that we have a new business coming here with about 500 high-paying jobs is proof of that. So it's not how much, it's really how are you doing it in the right way that's going to bring you the biggest bang for the buck.
How do you do that? How do you make sure the biggest bang happens for the buck?
Well, Ted, I want to just point out this never ends. I mean, it's not like we're doing this in isolation. There are 49 other states. We believe that we're doing more than any other state. And just getting back to the competitiveness package, I believe that Arizona was number one in the nation last year in terms of improving its position. We want to do more. And you mentioned capital gains. Farrell mentioned something on business property, which is important. There's more work that can be done. I also believe we're going to be in a period where it's going to be important to support the Arizona Commerce Authority to make sure that this new entity is properly working with the business community, which I'm sure it will be, to use all these wonderful new tools that the state passed last year.
I don't want to spend too much time on the Commerce Authority, but why is that necessary? When you've got the GPECs of the world, you've got other groups out there that are trying to woo business here, why is this necessary?
Well, I just want to first say that the GPECs and the TRIOs, these are world-class organizations, but it's a great question. Why is it necessary? In September, we participated in a trip to China with the Arizona Technology Council, with the Arizona Commerce Authority and with Governor Brewer. And what was fascinating to me is that for the Chinese business leaders and Chinese governmental officials, it was extremely important to have a credible statewide entity with the backing of the governor. And you could see in the statistics, my understanding is that the business leads are way up since the establishment of the Arizona Commerce Authority. The Commerce Authority, I think, is working very well with the regional economic development entities, and again, getting back to today's announcement, GPEC was at that announcement, but we need a center of gravity, and the Arizona Commerce Authority is that center.
It's something led by the Chief Executive Office of the state. It's important, I think, for folks in other countries to see that this is a statewide approach. The work that Barry's done has been tremendous. There's no question. I think that is just it complements what's going to happen at the ACA.
What kind of jobs are we? We keep hearing Arizona generating jobs, and yet we look at some of these jobs. Maybe are these the kinds of jobs we want, or is any job right now a good job?
Well, I mean, I think it depends who you talk to. There are a lot of people that look at this and say we lost 300,000 jobs in this recession. So I think when you look at this from a broad perspective, we need to look at this from all levels. But when you're incentivizing, I think we need to look at some of these high-wage, high-skilled jobs.
I want to get back, Farrell, when you mentioned tort reform. Right. And I want to talk to you about that because what needs to be done as far as – you're talking punitive damages here on things?
Ultimately, there is a constitutional issue when it comes to limiting someone's right to sue, and that's not something that I understand is going to is on the agenda this year, but there are some things you can do to make sure that certain procedures are in place that don't allow frivolous lawsuits to go forward and keeps the business community in a position where they can understand what their liability is going to go forward, their insurance costs won't go way up expanded rights to sue. To go back a little bit to the whole jobs question is, and Todd's exactly right, we lost 300,000 plus jobs in this recession. So as much as it's great to see a few hundred jobs come with this announcement, it's going to take thousands of years to get back to where we need to be if that's what we do every single day, is announce a couple hundred jobs here and there. We need to get huge chunks of jobs coming back here, and a lot of that comes down to some of these things we're talking about that aren't as sexy, don't get the headlines, but it's that having a regulatory environment and a tax environment and a litigation environment that says it's safe to invest money in Arizona, it's safe to hire workers here because you can make your way in the state.
I know that a lot of business concerns right now are obviously these sorts of things we're talking about, but other businesses tell me at least What they're looking for is customers. They need people with money in their pockets to go buy their stuff. Then they can hire more folks and we get more jobs. Is that on a separate plane, a separate track than the other things we're talking about, incentive packages and these sorts of things?
Well, it definitely is a consumer. It's a chicken and the egg kind of thing with the consumers and businesses. I mean, when businesses start hiring again and people start to feel more comfortable that they can spend money, I think that starts to spin the wheel. And so the velocity of money starts to increase, and all of a sudden you have people coming in the door. But you're absolutely right. When we talk to members at the Phoenix Chamber of Commerce, one of the biggest issues is we need people walking in the door. And so you've got to figure out a way to start that wheel spinning.
But Glenn, with budget cuts, with health care budget cuts, and I know that there's an idea out there with the bed tax, for lack of a better phrase, but with so many service cuts out there, folks that were getting assistance, not necessarily getting that assistance right now, how are they getting the money to come through and buy what you're selling?
Well, we do need to make sure access is funded at a higher level. Absolutely no doubt about that, Ted. But in terms of getting more dollars into the consumer's pockets, that's part of it. I think consumer confidence is part of it. You know, when I've had discussions with Todd over the many months, I mean, you contrast what we're doing on the state level, which directionally is about all in the right direction, contrast that with what's been happening on the federal level. And you know, things have not exactly been moving in a coherent fashion in Washington, D.C. And I think part of this is as we increase consumer confidence, we will see people loosening their wallets.
And to that point, we had a poll that recently went out with our members, and it's exactly what Glenn's saying. Looking at Arizona and the outlook on Arizona, people are actually pretty bullish on Arizona. But looking at the federal level, especially what's happening with Congress, that's where I think people are really reticent.
How are you seeing that balance between consumer confidence and consumer ability just to go out and buy something?
And I think you're seeing some of that with the foreclosures, where there was the original foreclosure wave. There were people who were just in houses they couldn't afford, but now you're seeing people being foreclosed on because they've already burned through their savings, they've lost their jobs. It's for economic reasons. And I think what we need as a nation is we need to get some of these all this uncertainty about the health care bill that will be hopefully at least in some way settled in June when the Supreme Court rules. Little shameless plug. The NFIB is the litigant on the individual mandate, so we're keeping a close eye on that. But also the labor situation with some of the rules coming down from the National Labor Relations Board, and what Congress is unable to do because of the gridlock in D.C. We're hoping that the elections that occur in about 11 months will give some sort of certainty going forward, so people can start making investments and have a better idea of what they're getting into when they put their money on the line.
I keep hearing uncertainty. We have economists on the show. They talk about uncertainty, and they talk about that quite a bit. And yet you also go past the other direction where you're saying, who cares about uncertainty? If folks have money, they're going to buy what you sell. What do you make of that dynamic?
Well, I think that uncertainty plays a huge role in this, and a lot of it is from what's happening at the federal level, the state level. People need to make sure, and I think Farrell's absolutely right, that the policies are going to be in place, for instance, on the regulatory reform, for them to be able to go out and hire people, and that there's not going to be a bunch of red tape there that's actually going to cost more and be more burdensome. So I think there's something to that.
How much can state, last question here, because we're talking about what you're looking for from the legislature. How much can the legislature really help business? Sometimes it's, you know, as someone famous once said, the government doesn't start knocking the door and say, I'm here to help you. That's not necessarily a good thing. What do you want to see from the legislature?
Legislature and the governor can and have been doing everything, just about everything possible to make the environment as conducive as possible for job creation. We want to see that focus continue into 2012.
What do you want to see?
I'd like to see some leadership on the health care exchange, obviously with the National Health Care Act that certainly we opposed. There is a mandate to create a state exchange or take a federal, all one size fits all. We need a state exchange. It's one of the things we really want to see this
interesting year. Farrell, what do you want?
Just hold the line on spending. The tax, the 1 cent sales tax goes away in a little over a year. It was supposed to be temporary, and boy, it should be temporary, and it should be retired as it was promised.
Gentlemen, it's good to have you here. Thanks so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.